can't get to Montgomery unless you come through Atlanta. And I just got to thank the city of Atlanta, the conscious community, the black community, because Atlanta, arguably at this point, and I've said this on the low for about a year or two now, Atlanta may have surpassed Chicago, Detroit, and New York City as the preeminent Dr. Umar support city. The amount of contacts I get from Atlanta, the amount of support, the amount of donations for the Frederick Douglass Marcus Garvey Academy, the turnout at the events, just all around, no matter how you look at it, no matter what angle, the celebrities who reach out and send me support, I think Atlanta might be number one right now. I mean, Chicago, Detroit, and New York are still there. You know, they're close, right? 1.5, but I think Atlanta might be edging all the other cities out. So it's always a pleasure and a joy to come back to the ATL, and I can't wait to get back into that shrine. Saturday night, 6 o'clock is going down, and we want everyone to come on out.
Well, you know, let me say, as a New Yorker who lives in this, in Atlanta, there's everyone from those cities you mentioned down here.
Yes,
so,
sir.
The conscious community is here, and we have a resurgence of unity and love this next month, trying to get the conscious community together. We know it's been fractured the last couple of years, but now we're trying hard to get it together, and it's happening. It's really happening. I feel it. We see it. My wife and I just came from a unity conference a few days ago here. We're trying to get all the communities to put aside some egos and, you know, ideologies, and just try to work to help our people. And first, let me say I thank you for helping the black man and woman of North America. As a clinical child psychologist, you are doing one of the things my wife will tell you when you meet her. This is all I've been talking about in my research. This is the thing that's going to help us the most, is dealing with the destruction of black families and psychology of how that destruction even happened. So thank you. Thank you. And thank you, Dr. Umar, for your sojourn in North America and then coming through the South, particularly these next few weeks.
Question, and let me say this to Atlanta. When I was there for Kwanzaa, I believe I was in Atlanta the third day of Kwanzaa, December of 17, and I had announced that Atlanta was a finalist city for the first Frederick Douglass Marcus Garvey Academy. Well, up until a couple of months ago, I was about 2 seconds away from purchasing a school in Atlanta. The only thing that changed the decision was my mother fell ill, and I am now her primary caregiver. She's doing well, so she's good, but I have to stay close, and she's here in Philadelphia. But I'm saying all that to say that Atlanta was the spot. It was the spot, but of course, loyalty and obligation is to home first, and so I had to pull back on that offer. But I was searching online the other day for other schools available, you know, around the country, and more specifically in this Northeast corridor, since I do want to try to keep my mom as close to family as possible. However,
yes, sir.
I had realized that the school that I wanted, the school I was going to purchase, is still available. I thought it was taken off the market because at the time the realtor told me someone else was eyeballing it, but it's still listed. I'm saying that to say that when I get to Atlanta tomorrow, I'm probably going to go back to that school one more time and just pick up the vibration. Sometimes you got to listen to spirit. And I'm going to go back to that school and just listen to spirit, because if spirit says this is where it needs to be, then me and my mom are going to have a long talk, and I'm going to ask her to give it an opportunity. You know, come on down with me to Atlanta, and let's see this thing through. So, you know, I'm not trying to get everyone's, you know, hopes up or anything like that. But in being honest, I did not expect being available. And so because it is, I think I owe it to myself and to our community to just take one more look at it, because maybe that is where I need to come.
Well, you know, Dr. Umar, there's signs in everything, as you know better than I do. And the fact that it's available, and the fact that you get love here, and the fact that I'm going to tell you, from being in the streets of Atlanta, we need a black boy school here that is Afrocentric and African teaching with African methodologies. We need that in Atlanta, because the black man and the black boy here needs that more than anything. You know that better than I do.
Yes, sir.
So I'm just going to say, let me be the first to tell you, if no one else is going to tell you, because Brother Michael don't bite his tongue. If you want to do that, you're going to have a full school, beloved. If you want to put your boy's school here, you're going to have a full school, because we need that. These black boys need to be separated from this enemy, this inimical system that is killing us, the water system, the whole thing. You already know, so I'm not preaching to you, but you know, you got it. You will have a full school, beloved. And so welcome to Atlanta. That's all I got to say, just like the airport says.
Yes, sir. My power.
But Dr. Umar, if I may, I just had a couple of questions about, well, how much time are you going to give us tonight? That's the first question.
I could give you a strong hour.
Okay, good, good. That's what that's actually exactly what we got. So we know the topic of the shrine is systematic destruction of black families. I just want to commend you for thanking, well, as a Nat Turner Library Radio Show producer, and also as a radio show host, you touched on a subject back in February when you came out the courthouse. The people didn't want to identify themselves. The only thing I was that caught my ear was the people who did not, they were classified, who were your accusers. Is that still standing correct?
Yes, sir, very much so. In fact, I'm waiting now to hear back from the Pennsylvania State Board of Psychology, because although we had that hearing, and obviously, you know, from anyone watching, I was victorious in that hearing, but at the same time, that hearing officer, who is a black woman, she does not have the final determination over whether or not I will be prevented from earning my license. So she can only make a recommendation to the Pennsylvania State Board of Psychology as to whether she feels that I was guilty of the charge. She already made her decision, and she says she found no information, no proof whatsoever that I had misrepresented myself as being what I am, which is a doctor of clinical psychology and a certified school psychologist. The issue was this, and that I do not have a license because I have yet to pursue it. And the reason I haven't pursued it is being a certified school psychologist, that takes up 99.9% of my time anyway. So
yes,
I really didn't need the license because my certification already covers all the work that I do with our children. In addition to that, Pennsylvania has a law that says if you are a certified school psychologist and if you are employed, you can practice privately. So in Pennsylvania, certified school psychologists can practice privately just as a licensed psychologist. That is the law. And those who watched that video heard me speak on that. Now, I'm assuming that the state was not aware that I knew my rights and that I knew the law, but I was
careful
in putting that out there because if I'm employed, I can practice privately. That's the law. And if that is the law, and no fact it is, I should have never been brought in for a hearing in the first place. The hearing was totally fraudulent once one understands what the law is. So, again, she decided in my favor, but she doesn't have binding decision-making power. She only recommends to the board who was not present and who have never met me. And so now I'm waiting back to hear the final decision from the Pennsylvania State Board of Psychology as to whether or not they will ban me from getting my license. And let me be clear, this was not motivated exclusively by white folks. It's the main people who were on this path, this agenda, to try to destroy me professionally were black. It was led by lesbians,
yes,
homosexuals, feminists, and reactionary multiculturalists.
Come on now.
You know, I felt like Marcus Garvey, you know, same thing he went through when W.E.B. Du Bois and A. Philip Randolph and other jealous Negroes tried to sabotage him, and he ended up in court on false charges. So it was almost Garvey 100 years later.
Well, Dr. Umar, let me be the first to thank you, because I told my wife will tell you, I saw that, and I said, that's where a brother like me come in, because when I hear classified in the conspiracy world, that's CIA, ADL, and they always go with the Negro that's scared to death to take us down, like at the Nat Turner Rebellion. When I did the first Nat Turner tour, white folk didn't stop Nat Turner. Brothers and sisters, it wasn't a big white army. They came later, but it was the fact that Nat Turner didn't want to kill his own people that were defending white folk. So anytime we have a rebellion or we have a strong black man or woman who's trying to help their people, it's always our own people that come against us. But
that's right.
But the audience has heard me say this, Dr. Umar. The audience has heard me say this. We have to come to the point in our own individual minds where we're going to realize we have to deal with traitors, and we have to deal with people who are our enemies here, we don't have the stomach for that. I know that. But we're going to have to deal with it. Because how dare our brother or sister do anything against a Dr. Umar or any of our black leaders or any of the black causes that are helping the people in the name of what? And that's the thing. So I want to thank you for standing strong. And I understand your Twitter page is back up. Is that right, Dr. Umar?
Yes, Twitter is back up, Instagram is back up, and Facebook is back up.
All you got to do, brothers and sisters, is speak the truth, and the devil will flee. And so, Dr. Umar, thank you for standing on that truth. And back to the school. I gave a couple of times to the school because there's an old saying a brother once told me, you put your money into what you believe. And so as soon as I saw what you were doing and I saw that video that you had about the school, I immediately gave, and then I gave again a month later. And so I want to continue to give. And so are you still collecting for the school?
Yes, I am. Anyone who wants to make a donation can mail it in, payable to the FDMG Academy, P.O. Box 6872, Philadelphia, PA 19132. So all of the donations are mail-in donations. Anyone who comes to the Atlanta lecture or the Montgomery, Alabama lecture Saturday and Sunday, and then, of course, I'll be in Suffolk, Virginia, down the road from that turn of land on next Sunday, July the 15th, they can always bring a donation. But I ask people not to give me cash if they can help it. If it has to be cash, please roll it up, put it in an envelope or something, and include your name, phone number, email address, because I keep a log of all donations. And once this school is open, I want to make sure we pay proper respect to those who have donated, and especially my repeated donors. You know, I really have to thank them because I got brothers and sisters who've been donating and supporting me consistently year in, year out, month in, month out, whenever they can for the past 4 or 5 years. So a very special tribute, you know, would have to be made for them. But they have to mail it in. There is no more online donation because the same group that went to the Pennsylvania State Board of Psychology also went to GoFundMe and had my GoFundMe shut down. They claimed that it was fraudulent, that I was stealing money. I had no intention of building a school. And obviously, the white people at GoFundMe wanted to believe that because although I provided them with all of the information they needed, the bank statements, the bank information, even told them they can call the bank, gave the bank clearance to answer any questions they had about the account to make sure every single penny was still there. And despite all of that evidence, they still shut down the account. The white folks wanted to shut it down anyway. But I think what made it easier for them to do that was they saw Negroes were also opposed to what I was trying to do. So it's the same little group of coons that seem to be totally motivated to bring about my demise, but it's not going to work.
Well, Dr. Umar, under Nat Turner Library Radio, we're coon-free, and let me use a proper language. We don't like coons around here. So what we do with those kind of brothers and sisters, put them in the enemy category, because if you defend the enemy, as I told a family member of mine years ago, then that means you are an enemy. Now, that may be a little more eccentric for some of our people, but I'm going to say that statement again, brothers and sisters. If anyone that you know that's an African descendant is defending an enemy to the rise of the black man and woman, then that individual is an enemy, and as an enemy, you should treat them. You don't befriend an enemy. You don't talk to an enemy. You treat them with an ostracizing methodology, because anyone knows that Dr. Umar has been helping us for a long time as a people. And the FDMG Academy has to happen. It's going to happen. They want to kill the baby before it started. And I thank Dr. Umar. Thank you, sir, for your perseverance through this. And I have a question from a brother who actually is a doctor and has to do with the FDMG Academy. He wants to know, will you consider crowdfunding to help the FDMG Academy and the community investments the same way Jay Morrison is in? He said he would like to donate and be the first to drop some funds toward it. And that's something that I guess, you know, I can put you in contact or have brother get in contact with you if you so wish. But that's a question. Would you like to address it now or off air?
Well, with the crowdfunding, I mean, GoFundMe is a form of that. I was never a fan of any of the crowdfunding platforms because of the percentage of the money that they take. You know, there's a fee for GoFundMe, and then there's a fee for WePay. which is actually the financial processing company that they use to transfer the funds and handle the money. And so ultimately they end up getting, like, I think somewhere between 7% and 12% of money's raised. Now that might not sound like much, but when you're raising hundreds of thousands of dollars, that's a nice chunk of money that they're, you know, taking from you, you know. But the only reason why I went to the GoFundMe platform is because many brothers and sisters said that they're too busy, and going to the post office to mail a check or money order was just too inconvenient. And so I ultimately, you know, gave into the pressure of the community to do the online site. But when GoFundMe shut it down, I mean, it was a gift and a curse. Obviously, it was, you know, not fortunate for those who like convenience of donating from their cell phone or their laptop. But at the same time, you know, it was a blessing, because now when you mail in a check or money order donation to the school, we get 100% of that money. You know, when it's a check or money order, we get
right,
it all.
Right.
But when it comes online, you know, they take their 7 to 12%. So depending on how you look at it, you know, it could be a good thing. It could be a not so good thing. As far as the brother Morrison goes, I'm aware of what he's doing. I haven't had an opportunity to study it closely because I'm so busy with my own agenda. But,
right.
You know, I'm open to different types of mediums, but it can't be, it needs to be the right thing, you know, and it has to feel right to me. So through the years, people have come to me with all types of fundraising mechanisms and all types of funding schemes and ideas that they had. And to be honest with you, none of them felt right. They were not, I felt they were not in the best interest of FDMG or what I was trying to do. I've even had people come and say, listen, I'll bankroll the whole thing, but I need a return on my investment. And I said, no, thank you. Because one thing about education, you know, for-profit schools don't do well. They never have, you know,
right.
Because you have to charge parents extra money just to make sure your investors get a return on their money. And when you look at the black boys who are going to need my school, a lot of their moms, most of course, three-quarters of our children are raised by the mother alone. They can't afford to be paying extra tuition because some thirsty Negro wants a return on their investment. The way I see it, when you donate to FDMG, that is the return on your investment. Seeing
Absolutely.
A new consciousness, seeing young black men provide for our queens and our children, seeing strong
right.
black men disciplined and organized, the return should not have to be financial. The return
right.
is a new people. The return is a new consciousness. The return is a liberated African population. That's the return on your investment. So I'm not a capitalist, and I do recognize that there's certain brothers and sisters out there who think they can use capitalism to save black people. I don't agree with
right.
that at all. You
Neither
know, I'm not
I.
against what
Neither
they're
do
doing, but I will not be using capitalism in any way, shape, or form to finance FDMG. If you give to this, you give because you care, not because you're looking for something in return.
I thank you for that statement. I couldn't echo anything better than what you just said. And in that spirit, you know, I was telling a brother the other day, we don't communicate well as a people, as you know, as a psychologist. You've dealt with enough of us to understand that communication is a pathology that we just didn't learn after slavery. So I want to give an opportunity to have you, if you got a first-time listener who never heard you say anything and don't know what FDMG is, if you want to start from the beginning of FDMG, what is it? What's the vision? What's the, you know, what's the execution, and how, and if you can go back into the website again, and then we'll go into something else later. Would you like to talk from that
certainly.
Perspective? Yes.
Certainly. I'll take a minute to do that for listeners who may not, because I try not to assume that everyone knows who I am. I would just want to reintroduce myself to them, you know, to let them know that I am a doctor of clinical psychology, a certified school psychologist, as well as a certified school principal and former school administrator. I'm author of the book, Psychoacademic Holocaust, The Special Education and ADHD War Against Black Boys, which is the only book in print that teaches black parents how to win against the miseducation machine, how to reverse diagnosis, how to get your kid out of special education. No other black or white author has ever written a book just for black parents, teaching them how to navigate the school system. I'm also author of my second book, which will be available for pre-sale by the end of the week, which is either Friday or Saturday, tomorrow, the day after. And that book is called Black Parent Advocate, The Art of War for Dealing with America's Public and Charter Schools. So with Black Parent Advocate, I get even more specific with the information included in Psychoacademic Holocaust. So again, anyone who's interested in ordering either book can order them, you know, directly from me if they want to. They can email me or they can text message me as well. And I'm also former Minister of Education for the Right Honorable Marcus Messiah Garvey's Universal Negro Improvement Association and African Communities League, which is the largest black organization we've had in modern history, the movement that gave us the red, black, and green flag. I'm also founder of the National Independent Black Parent Association, America's first national movement to organize black parents to fight against racism in the key areas of school finance, school policy, parent advocacy, social support, school, and other major areas, special education, and school discipline. And I'm currently raising money to build the first academy in America designed specifically for black boys, but based on the principles of revolutionary Pan-African nationalism and international finance. We have a lot of schools in America. We have a lot of independent schools in America, but none of them are based on revolutionary Pan-African nationalism. They might be culturally based, but they don't have the political Garvey influence, and that's exactly what our boys are going to have. And in that school, the six key sciences of FDMG will be political and military science. We're going to teach them how to defend themselves, both with and without weapons. Very important. That new movie is out right now, The Purge. I haven't seen it, but everyone's saying, Doc, you got to go see this movie because they're sending coded messages to black folks about what's being done to supremacy and how it operates, but more importantly, how to overcome white supremacy. Also very important. We know a lot about our history. We study our history. A lot of our scholars have done a great job in revealing to us the lost secrets of African achievement. However, we haven't done as good of a job making sure black people can interpret and understand and function in the world that they live in. And we've done a horrible job of preparing for our future. So political and military science curriculum will address that. And then there will be the economic and financial science, where we teach the laws of money, the laws of wealth, the laws of investing. This is going to be key because right now America is sending every black kid to college so they can go into long-term debt to the banks of America in the name of higher education. The United States government and the universities of America and the banks of America are in a tripartite organized financial conspiracy to put every black person in America into debt by way of higher education before they even get their first job. So we want to teach our young men and ultimately our young women when we open up the Anna Douglas and Amy Garvey Academy that you can become wealthy without a college degree. We're not against college. I want to be clear. I have 6 degrees myself. But we also recognize the times are changing, and we can't act like we don't see the fact that we have over 2 million unemployed black people who have both master's and doctorate credentials. There's other roads to wealth and a road to poverty. And then we're going to deal with agricultural and agronomical science. That's the science of Dr. George Washington Carver, the science of the land, knowing how to grow your own food, knowing how to test the soil, knowing how to use solar energy, knowing how to do aquaponics. We want to make sure that they are masters of raising their own food, because right now 75% of the blacks in America are dependent on whites and Asians to bring their food into their community. And if those whites and Asians decided to shut down their supermarkets, a lot of black people would starve to death because they don't know how to grow their own food. And then we move on over to science of the black man and black woman, which is your topic for tonight, which is saving that black family, teaching black boys how to be men, how to be husbands, how to be fathers, how to be sons. That's very important. How to be leaders. And most of all, how to work together with other black men so that we can protect the community in totality. Because we have a lot of strong, courageous black men, but many of those same strong, courageous black men have egotistical issues that prevents them from unifying and creating solidarity with other courageous black brothers so we can have a united front. It's very difficult for black men to have a united front because that ego of the Negro is often taking precedent over the people. I want to say that one more time. The ego of the Negro taking precedent over the people. And so until the black man gets his ego in check, humbles himself to his own brother, because we humble ourselves to white men every day, let's humble ourselves to our own brother, so we can respect one another and come together with mutual understanding and with a mutual purpose of protecting our elders, our women, and our children. And so that's going to be the Black Family curriculum. And then it will be an African spirituality curriculum where we teach all of the great spiritual sciences that make up the global African family. So not only will they learn about Ifa and Dogon and Kemet and the Asante system and Santeria and Palo, Lukumi, and all these variations of that original traditional earth-based spiritual system that our ancestors practiced before there was ever a Bible, a Quran, or a Torah, but I also want them to learn about those modern African spiritual systems. I want them to learn and embrace Rasta. I want them to learn and embrace Nation of Islam science, God and Earth science, Nawabian science. So without spiritual curriculum, although Pan-Africanism and traditional spirituality of the continent will take precedence, they will be exposed to the rich tradition, that entire multifaceted, multidisciplined spiritual hierarchy, or not even hierarchy because none is better than any other, but multi-spiritual community in which we live as a people. So they're going to get that, and I'm very much looking forward to that. And then we're also going to deal with, in addition to spiritual and cosmological, we have the dietary and nutritional science. That would be the sixth science, where not only do they learn how to grow the food in the agricultural science curriculum, but now they have to learn how to prepare the food, and that's the diet and nutrition. How do you get the most out of the human body based on what you put into the human body? And obviously, you know from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, How to Eat to Live, one of those landmark texts that deals with diet and nutrition. So we want to make sure that our boys have the science of a Dr. Sebi, the science of Ila Africa. We want to make sure that they master all the great sciences that come down through time from our people as it relates on how to feed the body and also how to preserve and protect the body as well. So we're looking to create a heaven on earth, and that's what we're going to do with those six sciences as the foundation, but with Africa and African consciousness as the elevation.
Dr. Umar, well, let me address the listeners real quick. Brothers and sisters who are listening, and with this blog talk system, y'all can listen months down the line. Dr. Umar then laid out a complete freedom idea. There is nobody who should have no problems with giving our brother whatever you got to spare for that kind of school. Now, Dr. Umar, did you pay me to say anything?
No, sir, not at all.
Okay. I'm going to say it again, brothers and sisters. Now, those of you who've been listening to the Nat Turner Library Radio for the last few years, you know we don't pull any punches. If you don't take some money and donate it to Dr. Umar for that kind of school, wherever it is on the planet, then, brothers and sisters, you are not for black people. I'm telling you that because the whole thing our brother just said, you know he articulated it that way because he's been thinking about it. And if he's been thinking about it, he's planning to execute it. So what that means, brothers and sisters, for all those naysayers who think our brother has some ulterior motives and all that mess that I hear about every other black leader throughout history, brothers and sisters, I'm trying to tell you, give some money to this school. If nothing else, you can say, I contributed to something that was uplifting our people. Doesn't matter what group you're from, what religion you're in, don't matter what part of the country you're at. Give to this school. I would love for somebody to present that whole outline to Oprah and all the rest of them just to see where they at. Well, I already know where they at. But there shouldn't be no reason that brother shouldn't have $1 billion for everything he just described. The black woman in Atlanta, Dr. Umar, and I talked to these sisters out here. They all crying because they looking for men. And the solution is in the types of schools and in the organizations that are trying to make men. But you need a school that has a curriculum to make men African men. And that's what our brother is trying to do, listeners. Dr. Umar, thank you for that explanation. Did you have anything to add about that segment before we get into the family?
Yeah, let me say this quickly. People often ask the question, what is the purpose of life? And the purpose of life is to manifest God by creating a heaven on earth. When you look at the heaven, there is order. When you look at the heaven, there is beauty. When you look at the heavens, there is trust. You trust that the sun is going to rise every day. It never fails you. You trust that the moon is going to be up. You trust that there's going to be four seasons every year. You trust that the rain is going to come to water your crops so your family can eat that following harvest. See, heaven has all the principles that we need on earth. It has the trust. It has the harmony. You see reciprocity in heaven. Whatever system takes from another, it also replenishes. So when the water hits the ground, guess what? We didn't have evaporation. It gives it right on back to the heaven again. So every principle that we need to survive as a people, we already see it in operation in heaven. So this summer, in about 2 weeks, God willing, we'll be going to Kemet and Abyssinia, Egypt and Ethiopia for 2 weeks. And when people look at those great civilizations, the greatest in human history, and they say, not only how did they build this, but they ask why. Why did our ancestors over 5,000 years ago pull, you know, 1- and 2-ton blocks from out of the water into the middle of a desert? And they created the greatest civilization in world history in a desert. So in a place that shouldn't have anything, they gave us everything. And they lined up every temple. They lined up every obelisk. They lined up every shrine to be in direct geometrical proportion to the heavens above. So if you were in heaven looking down on earth, you would see a mirror image of yourself. That is the purpose of why we're here. Not to necessarily build a pyramid, but to recreate the principles for why the pyramid was built, and that is to put heaven on earth. And the purpose of FDMT is to socialize and educate our boys so that they will be able to give black people a heaven on earth. Because right now, we have a hell on earth. And it's our job as men to transform this hell into a heaven. Heaven on earth is the reason we are here. And to the extent that black people can create that heaven, we will be blessed by Almighty God. We will be blessed by Supreme Consciousness. And to the extent that we fear of the white man, we will be cursed by our Lord for failing to fulfill the very mission for why we were put here in the first place.
You just echoed the words of the Honorable Miss Luz Farrakhan. He said, you can't be a coward and be with God. And that is the truth, Dr. Umar. Brothers and sisters, Dr. Umar, if you would, as we close that part of it, can you tell the brothers and sisters in the audience how they can contribute to the FDMG school one more time?
Yes, indeed. Checks and money orders can be mailed out payable only to FDMG Academy, and they should be mailed to P.O. Box 6872, Philadelphia, PA 19132. If you did not get that, you can email me directly, drumarjohnson@yahoo.com. I'm the only one who checks my email, except along with Homeland Security and CIA. But the email address,
National Security Agency,
drumarjohnson, no period, no space, drumarjohnson@yahoo.com. And if you need to call me, I have a text line, and then I have a voicemail line. If you need to leave a voicemail, call 844-4-DR-UMAR. Again, that's 844-4-DRUMAR. If you want to shoot me a text message, you can use 215-989-9858. So a lot of people have been asking about the tickets for the lecture in Atlanta Saturday night. They've been looking on my EventBee platform. Well, the Atlanta tickets are not on my EventBee platform because the Shrine of the Black Madonna is hosting this event, not Dr. Umar Johnson. So I'm not renting time. They've actually invited me in to do a lecture on their production. So if you need tickets to the event this Saturday, then you can text me and I will text you the link. Again, that's 215-989-9858. Now, if you're coming to Montgomery, Alabama on Sunday or Suffolk, Virginia next Saturday, or Elizabeth City, North Carolina, Raleigh, North Carolina, August the 31st and September 2nd, respectively, then you would get those tickets at drumarjohnson.eventb.com. So, again, if anyone needs to reach me, feel free to do so.
Yes, I didn't mean to interrupt you. Brothers and sisters, the EventBee page for Dr. Umar, we just posted to the Nat Turner Library Radio Facebook page. They may not want you, but we don't mind putting your stuff on there, Dr. Umar.
My wife can tell you, I really
can give a damn about what Satan wants to do. He done started with me years ago, so I can care what they can't threaten me with nothing. What they going to do, take my house and car away? I still got my soul. So the reality is Umar's event page information for Event B for his tour is on this page. And brothers and sisters, according to the event B, I'm just going to go through it real quick, if I may, since you brought it up, Dr. Umar. School, you're going to Montgomery, Alabama on July 8th, is that right?
Yes,
at 4 p.m.?
Correct.
Okay. All right. So the topic there would be the special education and ADHD hoax. Hope to see that. Brothers and sisters, Dr. Umar on July 15th will be in Suffolk, Virginia. You will be speaking on the State of Black America Power Lecture. All right. Brothers and sisters, Dr. Umar on August 31st will be in Elizabeth City State University, HBCU, as they call it, over there in Elizabeth City. That will be at 9 p.m. on Friday, August 31st, 6 p.m. to 9. The subject will be Psychoacademic War Against Black Boys, ADHD, Autism, and IEP. I don't even know what that is, brother. The next time is going to be September 2nd, the Revolutionary Black Family. That's going to be in Raleigh, September 2nd, Sunday at 4 p.m. That is going to be where is that going to be? It doesn't show it on here, but get your tickets on.
There is a church. It's escaping me at present, but there's a church in Raleigh where we'll be at on a Sunday, September 2nd.
Okay. Well, brothers and sisters, buy the tickets anyway, and you'll get the information of where it's going to be. The next one is going to be September 14th, Psychoacademic Holocaust, The Truth About Special Education and ADHD, September 14th in Shreveport. And it rounds off on Event B with the Return to Dallas, Texas, The Psychology of Liberation, Sunday, September 16th. Did I miss anything in that upcoming schedule, there, brother?
No, sir. You got it all. Atlanta, Montgomery, Suffolk, Elizabeth City, Raleigh, Shreveport, Dallas.